I've been planning this documentary for a good little while now. I'm just blessed and happy that I'm able to do it now. But the purpose behind it is for people, you know, who still going through their process in life, you know, who still struggling, you know, those depressed, you know, those feel like ain't no way out. This is for them. You know, a lot of people do documentaries, you know, when they make it, when they say this BS story, you know, they, you know, all you gotta do is work hard, and, you know, you'll get the rhyme, man, and all that stuff. But, you know, this is for like the real life, you know, to show you that, you know, I'm still going through my process and I ain't perfect, you know, and I ain't where I want to be right now. But I'm gonna get there though. You know, it's all about the journey and enjoying your valley, you know, so you can appreciate the mountaintop. And that's what this is all about. It's the third documentary.
Relentless stage of this shit. Once again, yeah. Don't know how I talk about money back when I was poor.
How you do that?
Had to speak it to existence like a magic show.
It ain't no more pity parties. No more woe is me. I'm sad. I'm depressed. I'm down. You know. You know. We all go through them emotions. But man, it really ain't no more excuses for real. Like. Ain't no excuse, man. I used to have all the excuses. I used to be the spokesperson for a pity party committee. You know, I used to always, you know, blame everybody else for my problems and never took responsibility. Every issue I had, you know, I always felt, you know, oh, I'm black or this, play the race card, or I ain't get this job because of this or. Like, bro, I had a million and one excuses to not go get it and not go grind. And that's why I stayed in the same situation I stayed in so long. That's why I was down bad so long. Until I had to wake up and realize, like, bro, it's you. Like, you the problem. Like, you know what I'm saying? You gotta fix it. I say my greatest talent is patience. My whole life, it seemed like I've been having to be patient for a breakthrough, for something to change, something big, you know, to come. And, you know, as life continues, patience really shows you who you really are and shows how much faith you have in God and just trust in Him. And because my entire life, you know, I've been told I was special and, you know, here you're gonna be something, you're gonna be somebody, you're gonna do amazing things. And even up to now, I'll continue to hear these things and hear when you make it, when you get rich, when you get successful, make sure you pull somebody up and make sure you help the next man. And I've been hearing this my whole life, and it's crazy because, like, when I was hearing these things, I could not see this stuff. Like, I could not see what people were seeing in me, and it's like not until now I'm finally understanding and realizing, you know, that's been God's favor the whole time. I graduated 2017. Man, right after graduation, it was literally like a blur. Like, I had like no idea really of, you know, what I wanted to do. You know, I got my degree and stuff like that, but, you know, I didn't really prepare myself, you know, as I was supposed to coming out of college. So I was just kind of like, you know, I need to get a job. That's all I knew. I need to get a job. I need to go work somewhere, work for somebody. I mean, it really was just cut and dry. And so I hit the ground running. Man, it was like every single day. You know, I'm in there, like, I'm going to apartment complex, different apartment complexes in Starville, you know, getting their computers, applying to jobs. I mean, whoever had a job open, I was applying to it, as long as it wasn't fast food. So I had my application in their system. And no matter who, like, I was just shooting out. And, you know, and at this time, like, my mind went open to, like, you know, just go out and venture out. Nothing. It was just kind of like I was trying to base everything kind of off my area and where I was at, you know, in Starkville. And, you know, man, jobs real scarce in the area or whatever. So, I mean, it just seemed like it was no hope, just being honest.
So would you say that your passion for basketball really influenced you going to college?
Yeah, that's the main reason I went to, you know, going to college was basically for basketball. But of course, I didn't get the opportunity, you know, due to politics, just kind of how that go. But it was like, when I didn't get that shot I was looking for, that's what basically made me kind of, you know, I had to take school more serious than I did, you know, especially with me going Greek as well, becoming a Nuke, you know, with them, they had a GPA at a certain level. So I did have to take school seriously, but initially basketball was my main priority going into college.
All right, so with basketball being your main priority going into college, how, after college, did you continue to pursue basketball?
Yeah, so me, like I said, I was going to these different apartment complexes, you know, trying to look up stuff and get jobs. And I can remember vividly, it was one day, I'm in there and I was applying somewhere. I can't even remember. But I just got like fed. I think it was like AT&T or something. And I thought I got like fed up. I was just like, man, I'm through with this shit for real. Like, so I just walked outside. And I was still by the pool, and I was just like looking up to the sky, like, man, like trying to just talking to God, like, you know, like this can't be life, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was still working the same job, like, you know, it was just like everything was kind of crumbling. And I get a call from my dad, and my dad lived in Memphis, so he called me, and he like, man, you still trying to play ball? And I was like, play ball? Like, what you mean? Basketball? And let me tell you, I ain't hooped in like over a year now. Like, I ain't hooping at all. I done about gave it all up.
So, with you being, how can I say, with you being so, with having so much love for the game, but not playing it in a while, did that kind of alter your mindset when you got that call from your dad? Like, did you have any doubts or?
Oh yeah,
I gotta push myself now.
Most deaf. I had all the doubts in the world. Like, I had felt basically every emotion. Like, I mean, I knew it was gonna be hard, and I knew it was gonna be a challenge. But I mean, I feel like, you know, it happened for a reason. Like, God, you know, aligned there for a reason for me to you know, make that into my journey and chase that dream again. So I got that call. He told me, you know, by the guy in Memphis, you know, basically an overseas opportunity. You know, I just got to train about 8 months, 9 months, get back in shape, and shit, the tryout was going to be that July. So I got this call around, what, November, December? So it was kind of like, so I got the call, it was instant, like, grind time, like, straight to the gym.
So what was the process like getting ready for the tryout? I mean, just the whole process in general, from trying out to moving to Memphis to trying to start a new life after college. How did that process go?
So basically, that new year came, 2018 came, and man, 2018 was one of my most craziest years ever, just through just depression, just life struggles, man. At this time, with me knowing the opportunity of going overseas, I'm still in Starkville. And on the low, like, you know, I ain't really told nobody nothing. Like, I'm just practicing every day, hooping every day, working out. You know, kind of like the people who know. But, man, I was literally, like, training every single day, nonstop, every single day, trying to get myself back in shape and just, you know, prepare myself. Because I knew it was going to come quick. And at this time, I was actually a DP. The spring 18 line that came through Capitals. So I'm balancing a whole lot right now. Trying to train, do that, you know, just a whole lot of everything kind of going on. You know, but I still made it work.
So, you know, with your dad calling you, giving you the opportunity, or telling you about the opportunity, you moving up to Memphis, how did your relationship with your dad change?
Okay, so basically, so I get to Memphis. So it get around May. I shoot to May. That's when I decide I need to go on, move, make that move. And I packed up everything, quit my job, and just really like laid it all on the line. Like, I'm finna move to Memphis and I'm finna make that dream work one way or the other. And I moved to Memphis, and me and my dad, we was already close, you know. So me calling him, telling him, man, Dad, I'm finna come up there with you, you know, so I can be close to the trainer. And we can make this work. And you know, he believed in me. He opened doors to me, and you know, I tried to make it happen. And I had to make some sacrifices.
All right. So you know, you said earlier the trials rolled around July. So when you get to the trials, what was it like? What was the experience or the emotions you felt when you walked through the door? Yeah. It was like, I actually got this chance, and I'm actually here.
Yeah. So. So I would bust my ass, man, working out, man. I had told my dad I was trying to get a little job, basically, and that didn't work out. You know, I worked there about a week. I worked at Dollar General for like a week, and I told my dad, I said, man, Dad, I ain't got no money. I ain't got nothing right now. I'm just up here trying to go hoop, and I just need to support me. So July rolling around, me and my dad catch a flight to Vegas. That's where we tried at. So we get to Vegas, and man, I walk in there, I see all them guys, man, guys playing the D-League, you know, college athletes, you know, everybody you can think of in there, like, dang, like, this is it, you know, and I'm just, you know, just here, Louisville, Mississippi, you know, I'm just in there, and I know I got game, you know what I'm saying, like, people who know I can hoop, you know what I'm saying, so, like, I know I can hoop with them, but it's like, you know, I was nervous, I ain't gonna lie, I was nervous, but I was excited more than anything.
All right, so you airball your first shot.
Most definitely, yeah.
What happens after that?
Man, so I get out there and I'm straight. Hey, I got that ball. I let that be ride. I let that be ride. I ain't going to cap. I let it ride, and I airball for sure. But I knew, I said, I just had to get one out the way. And after that, man, it was a beautiful performance. Man, I think I ended the game with like 22 that game. Man, I could just remember just looking over at my dad. Like, he couldn't even sit down, man. He was so happy, man. It's like I couldn't miss nothing, you know, at all. It was crazy.
Junior, Junior. I just caught the Mary Jean chain clank. She thinks she hearing things. I just counted up 100 bands with all my dogs at the Airbnb. All they trying to be me. Got a new Hellcat, stay clear of me. And I got extended clip for all these.
Yeah, about the first shot, you dropped 22. Coaches all in your face, getting all your contacts. And I remember you saying that you didn't receive a call back.
Right.
So after not receiving a call back, how did that alter the plans again?
So, with me not getting the response I was looking for, I was hurt, because I basically gave up a whole year of my life training. Not saying that's enough. I that's a true sacrifice, you know, where I was down bad, you know what I'm saying, where I was literally, I seen $0 a couple times, you know, so I know I truly, you know, sacrificed for it. And for me not to get, you know, what I was looking for, it hurt, you know. But the blessing in it is that through that whole process, you know, I was looking up other things of, you know, financial things, education. I was picking up books. I was reading. I was learning about real estate and things like that. So that's kind of how the real estate part got into it, with it being more of like, not necessarily, I wouldn't expect it to be a backup plan, but it turned out being a backup plan, which got me to where I am, you know, to where I am right now, and as far as I am with real estate.
Now, I remember you saying that real estate was never really a part of your plan, but was just kind of like hinted in your life as you went on.
Yeah, right, right.
So would you say that God took you through what you went through to show you that, hey, this is a route that I think you should take?
Yeah, most definitely. I feel like if I never chased that dream, I wouldn't have ended up in Memphis. And even if I didn't chase it, I still don't even know how far I would have got with real estate. You know, it's like everything kind of balanced out how I need to balance out. It was like perfect timing. And man, even me moving to Memphis, just the people I've met through the jobs I worked and just the reception and the love of the city, man. I don't think I could have got this anywhere else. But I mean, but the way, like, you know, God got favor for sure in my life. You know what I'm saying? So even if I moved to New Hampshire, Delaware, anywhere, he would have placed the right people. You know, he was going to find a way for sure to make sure I was straight.
You call to see if I was home and sleeping and get boring. My landlord tripping on my speakers because the low end. You pull up with no warning. This the season for us growing. Let's go deep in the unknown. But by evening will be morning. You leave me with no warning.
Your same exact situation that you complained about, crying about. Somebody had that same situation and they winning right now. My support system, man, that's a beautiful thing. Like me moving back to Louisville in fifth grade was probably the best thing that ever happened to me. I moved back and forth so much because my parents divorced. You know, I was at an early age. I did a lot of moving, but just so happened, I was in fifth grade. I was living in Memphis with my dad, and I ain't even got asthma, none of that, but I just so happened to have some kind of breathing attack out the blue. And the first person I called, my aunt down in Louisville, and she panicked and all that stuff. And she told my dad, like, yeah, it's time for him to, he need to come down here with us. And it was like the rest is history. And my grandparents, aunts, my cousins, man, they just took me in and just treated me like I was definitely one of theirs, you know, and the love was so good. I needed all that, just with so much I've been through at an early age. They supported me in everything I did, whatever I needed, they had me. And it's just, even now, it's just the love done grew so much over time, just them seeing me growing, how much I done been through with them. And the hardest part of that whole process was probably losing my grandfather back in 2009. His death really changed my life for the better. You know, me and him had some long talks before he passed, and it really turned my life around, literally 360, to want to do better in school and, you know, and put certain things down and just, you know, really be a man and take care of business and man up, you know what I'm saying? And I appreciate him forever, you know, and I hold his name, you know, I'm the third. And, you know, because of him, I want to continue that legacy for sure. And my dad, and just keep that going. Overall, I love my family to death. And family, and I got friends as well who, you know, I treat they the same way. Like, they ain't even friends, you know. If you got anything to do with, you know, my journey and where I am now, you most definitely is my family. That's family for sure. Making sure I'm always good, making sure I'm straight, and I just can't thank y'all enough. Like, for real, like. From, like, genuinely saying, like, I can't thank y'all enough, and I love y'all for real.
And now that, you know, you went through real estate school, I remember you saying you took the test 4 or 5 times before you passed.
Yes.
So you fought your way through real estate. Now that you're getting started, what's your plans for the future? you know, once you get established and, you know, once you get a firm, ultimately, hopefully open your own firm.
Right.
What's the plans for the future for Hillard Smith and give it back to his community?
Man, I'm letting y'all know now. I took that test 5 times, y'all. So, man, perseverance, dedication, all that, I knew I wanted it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I knew I wanted to be a realtor. And I could have been gave up. And it's like, with the lifestyle, you know, whatever, I had a choice. You know what I'm saying? I could have went left or right. I could have dwelled, you know, on my losses and just, you know, did whatever, you know, got rid of anything, you know, but I chose to go the other way. And I chose to make a better living for myself. And ultimately, since I do got my realtor license, it is a lot I do want to do. I do want to be a broker. I do want to own my own firm. And there's things I do want to do, especially back home in Louisville, Mississippi. I just want to, you know, reach out down there and get through the high schools and do some workshops and teach kids about financial education and entrepreneurship and about college and making sure that you know got scholarships, that you're not paying arm and a leg for these student loans, because like debt, man, all this debt for no reason, you know, that we literally getting jobs just to pay back something I had to learn. Like I don't, the process is crazy to me, but if you got, you know, scholarships, stuff like that, I want to teach about that, or even teaching the fact that college ain't for everybody. You know, we ain't gotta just promote college all the time. Like, it's some people who out here who really don't like school, and even I'm a culprit of that for sure. I'm a victim of that. Like, I hate school for real, but I finished and I did it. You know, like I said, my whole intention was just to play ball. Like, but I made something out of myself, and I made some, you know, out of it. So it's like, you know, and I'm still pressing through. You know what I'm saying? Like, I ain't nowhere where I want to be. You know, I'm still on my journey. I'm still, you know, I'm still trying to get it every day. So I just want y'all not to ever give up, you know, because I'm on a journey with y'all. You know what I'm saying? You trying to get somewhere, I'm trying to get somewhere.
So in conclusion, what you're really trying to say is it's not how you begin, it's how you finish.
Exactly.
And it's not about winning the race, but it's about how you win the race.
Exactly.
So with that being said, I remember you saying that 2 years ago, you told your grandma that before she dies, you're going to show her a million.
Oh, yeah.
and you said that it scared you because the council came back and,
yep,
you know, you was going through a lot and,
yep,
you pushed through it. So what's one thing that you have to say to that one young man that's watching you and that's saying, hey, all right, this is the guy that I'm watching as an example?
Right.
What do you have to say to that one young man, or it could be a young woman,
right,
that's watching you right now?
Man, speaking into existence before you get it. Claim it before you get it. And know that everything gonna come with trials and shit. Like, it ain't always gonna be sunny. You know what I'm saying? It's always gonna be something to come up, but it's how you overcome it. And life don't get no easier, you know. What the old folks say, just keep living. I mean, just keep living, you know, but it do get better. It do get better. And I want y'all to do what y'all love, not what somebody tell y'all to do or somebody down you or something like that. Like, people gonna doubt you. Man, I got a story right now, literally a week ago, and this off the table, like, this really happened like a week ago. I'm in the gym working out, and it's this guy that worked there. You know, I know him pretty good. He's an older guy, though. You know, he kind of come up on me and was like, man, I heard you doing real estate now. I was like, yeah, you know, that's cool. Yeah, I'm doing real estate now. I just passed my test. And he like, didn't you work at a factory job? I was like, yeah, for a little minute I did. You know, I was focused on school, so I had to let it go. You know, he was like, you know, that's a real job, right? I was like, okay, yeah. And he was like, so you really think you gonna sell a house? I said, excuse me? He said, you really think you gonna sell a house? Like, do you know somebody right now ready to buy or sell a house? I said, yeah. I said, I've been blessed with connections and stuff. You know, I'm pretty sure I can, you know, I'm gonna make my way pretty nice in the industry. You know, I'm gonna be okay. But you know, that ain't no real job, right? Show me your bank account. You guys, how many zeros you got in your bank account? See, I'm retired. So I got money in my account. I'm good. My house costs $500,000. I said, oh, okay. That's real nice. I said, but I'm an entrepreneur. I'm working for myself. This man really said, oh, that's what all young folks say they want to do, because they lazy.
What?
Man, listen. I ain't never in my life disrespect nobody. But that day, I just wanted to say, it was a lot of things I wanted to say to him. But all I did was take that and just put it in my pocket. And just, like, people like him, like, you just gotta, show him. Like, you ain't gotta do nothing. You ain't gotta flex on, you ain't gotta stunt on. You just gotta just elevate. And he gonna see it. And see, people like that, you're going to have people like that. And that person could be your mama. That person could be your daddy. That person can be your best friend down you. Just elevate and do what you love so it won't be working.
Times, I ain't telling no lies, I just run it up. Never let a hard time humble us. Double up. I ain't telling no lies, I just,
yeah.
I ain't telling no lies, I just.
5, 4, 3, 2, that's time. I got to you that money. My dreams come true, my life. In diamonds.